All right, welcome everyone to the John and Mary Louise Riley Seminar Series at Bodega Marine Laboratory with the Coastal Marine Sciences Institute at UC Davis. I'm Andrew Whitehead, and it's my distinct pleasure to welcome our distinguished speaker this week, Dr. Lauren Sallon. So Dr. Sallon is joining us today from University of Pennsylvania. So Lauren earned her PhD in integrative biology from the University of Chicago and was then a Michigan fellow. And she's currently the Martin Marison Assistant Professor in Interdisciplinary Studies at the University of Pennsylvania. So Lauren's received a number of awards throughout her career, including an Early Career Paleoichthyologist Award and a Distinguished Service Award. She's just recently last year received an NSF Career Award, which are pretty hard to come by, and is also a senior TED Fellow. If you haven't seen her TED Talks, you should go check them out because she's an excellent communicator of her science. So Lauren's known for using really big data approaches, including evolutionary trees, morphological data, biomechanical data, developmental details, to really understand how global events and environmental change and ecological interactions shape macroevolutionary processes and establish the biodiversity that we see around us today. Much to the chagrin of people that study birds, fishes are actually the most diverse of vertebrates. And it's really that amazing biodiversity in fishes that that Lauren is really looking at through a deep time lens. What I really appreciate about Lauren's research is, which distinguishes her, I think, from a lot of paleontologists is that she really thinks beyond systematics and really tries to grapple with difficult questions about the ecology of early fishes. So I'd encourage you to have a look at some of her papers, really great, big picture papers that have been published, especially in the last 2 years. There was an amazing paper in Science in 2018, another Nature paper in 2018. 2018 was a big year. And a lot of other papers in her distinguished career so far, including a paper on the Tully Monster. And if you don't know what a Tully Monster is, Google it. They're the weirdest creatures I think I've ever seen. Anyways, I'm really pleased to have Dr. Sallon joining us today and look forward to her seminar. One quick piece of business here is we're doing a webinar version right now rather than a regular Zoom instance. So if you have questions, I'd encourage you to type them into the Q&A function, not into the chat function. And then at the end of Dr. Sallon's seminar, I will help sort of curate some of those questions during the question and answer period. So with that, I'll hand it over to Dr. Sallon.
Thank you so much, Andrew. And thank you for inviting me virtually. I met a lot of very nice people today, especially grad students, and I'm really excited to introduce the research that I've been doing to all of you, especially at a marine lab setting, which I haven't been able to do before. All right, so first off, as an overview, what I'm most interested in is macroevolution. And I know there's a lot of people in this audience that don't need an introduction to that, but basically it's evolution above the species level and over very long timescales. So this includes things like how species diverge from one another, how they're related to one another, the classic phylogenetics, but also things like mass extinctions, how evolutionary faunas change, how major clades originate and diversify, and then how they react to ecological factors such as species interactions and such. So the main components, just to summarize that again, are diversification. How do we get a lot of different species? What axes do they diversify on? Why do they look so different from each other? Why don't we just have one species that's everywhere? And of course, extinction, both mass extinction, like this asteroid impact 65 million years ago in very dramatic fashion, but also background extinction. That is, how do we know we're in a mass extinction? What is the normal rate of extinction? How does that change through time? Why do some species go extinct while other ones survive? Another aspect that I look into is macroecology in sort of the broadest sense. So that is, how do species interactions like predation or competition shape macroevolution over long timescales? And that's actually an open question as to whether those actually do have any kind of significant effect on evolution over long times. So it may be that major groups interact with each other. The classic example, this is something like dinosaurs or mammals. But on the flip side, there's also the case of brachiopods and bivalves, where it seems like they don't actually interact much. And the decline of one and the rise of the other is termed ships passing in the night. And then I combine all of these together to try to get at why do we have the biodiversity that we have today. So in the specific instance of my research, I'm looking at vertebrate biodiversity, which tends to be represented in the modern by three specific groups. That is the ray fin fishes with about, so the slide's kind of old because it's probably now about 35,000 species. Every single time that I put the slide up, it seems to go up. And they are the most dominant group, including things like tuna and salmon and most fish that you can think of. The second largest group are the tetrapods, whose numbers increase at some rate as well. In this slide, they have 30,000 species. And that's, of course, us and other things that have four limbs. And then you have a lesser number of sharks with about 1,200 species, and then a smattering of other vertebrates like the lobe-finned fishes, such as coelacanths and lungfishes, or the jawless fishes, which are lamprey and hagfishes. And so it seems pretty evenly divided between the two primary groups if you look overall. But if you go into aquatic ecosystems, and again, this is a marine lab, so I don't have to go too far into that, fishes are even more ecologically important than they might seem. So there's been a lot of attention to vertebrate evolution. Vertebrates are usually used in as a term for mammals or maybe tetrapods, but fishes are, of course, the more dominant group, especially in aquatic settings. And so their dominance is best illustrated by a chart like this, where it's just diversity in waters, in freshwaters, in marine. And you can see that there's not very much else vertebrate-wise that exists there. Fishes are also important to study from a macroevolutionary point of view because they're ecologically distinct. That is, there have been a lot of studies, especially in the fossil record, of things like tetrapods, of things like benthic, marine mollusks and other things with shells, and even other marine invertebrates. But fishes tend to occupy different trophic levels than other aspects of marine ecosystems. They tend to do different jobs in aquatic ecosystems. They tend to be top-down controls and predators and things like that. And so it's very important to study fish macroevolution with a focus on fish macroevolution to have a better understanding about how these evolutionary processes play out as a whole. And fishes present several advantages for macroevolutionary study as well, especially looking back in time. For one thing, they tend to be very diverse in the modern. So those 35,000 species aren't evenly distributed in terms of phylogeny. Some groups are really, really diverse, things like teleosts and then subsets of teleosts, like the spiny ray teleosts. Whereas other groups are what we might call living fossils, where they're not really diverse at all anymore and they're doing very specific jobs. And so we can make comparisons within the group between things that have been very, very evolutionary successful and things that have not been, and ask questions as to why. Past fishes, fortunately, were even more diverse. So the subset that we have today, where it's mostly just teleosts and a few sharks, is just a subset of all of the fishes, that is every vertebrate that is not necessarily a tetrapod, that have evolved since the beginning of the group sometime back in the Paleozoic, so about at least by 525 million years ago. Some of these groups are now completely extinct, things like big armored placoderms, but also relatives of the modern ray fin fishes and the modern sharks were also extinct. And so we can go back and see how these processes of diversification play out, if there are any commonalities, and if they tell us anything about how evolution operates. The nice thing about fishes is that they have a really great fossil record if you cherry pick the images. So they have the same features that we would look at in living fishes preserved in the record across that, say, 450 million years. So we can see things that are ecologically relevant, such as the size of the eyes, the position of the fins, which has, of course, an impact on their swimming mode. We can see their teeth, we can see their jaws, we can see their stomach contents. We get a real idea of the animal that's not necessarily something that we can take from, say, fossil shells alone or other groups like tetrapods where the fossils tend not to be articulated. And so we can make a one-to-one comparison between fishes in many different groups in the fossil record and the kinds of fishes that we see today. And we can also use the lessons from, say, the biomechanics of modern fishes to try to infer the capabilities and the ecologies of past forms. And so that really touches on what I think is the biggest benefit of fishes, which is the fact that we can infer things like function pretty well from form at this point. So the position of the fins does affect how they swim. We see the repeated evolution of the same shapes. And so again, we can get at something like ecology. So the way that I go about looking at these things is through data analysis. Like I mentioned, is the fossil record is really, really vast for fishes. And there are a lot of different species that have lived over the last 450 million years. And so that lets us my lab and my students that are working on these things, it lets us compile data on where fishes occur, what their biogeography is like, what their shape is like, what their teeth are like, what their stomach contents are like, what their habitat is like, for a data set that stretches into the tens of thousands of different entries for different species and different populations. So it's a lot to work with, it's a lot to handle, but it ends up letting us see things play out repeatedly. It lets us make direct quantitative comparisons to really get at those major drivers of macroevolutionary change. So to illustrate how this works, how all of this comes together, I'm going to show you some results in my lab and how this sort of quantitative big data approach has revealed new lessons about the macroevolution and the impacts of mass extinction in early vertebrates. That is, vertebrates during the first 250 million years of their evolution and what that tells us about how evolution works. So to start with that, we have to go back to the beginning. So this is Haiku Ichthys, who's one of the earliest vertebrates that we know of. It's found in Changjiang in China, so about 535 million years ago or so. It doesn't look all of that impressive. It has eyes at the front end, which is how we know that it's definitely a vertebrate and not something that might be related to vertebrates. It has gill openings. It has a post-anal tail, which is a very important vertebrate characteristic. And from here, most people would assume that vertebrates then take over the world because, as I mentioned, they're ecologically important. And it's kind of hard for us to imagine a sea without fishes. Except that if you go, say, 100 million years later, that's exactly what you find. So this book, A Sea Without Fish, is about one of the best known early reef faunas in Ohio, so the Cincinnati Arch region. Massive reef, massive relative cephalopods live there. Early corals, which are not quite like modern corals, but at least they're related, and a whole other bunch of other benthic marine invertebrates. But there is not a single fish found there. And in fact, the people that work there, this group called the Dry Dredgers, repeatedly ask, where do we find the fishes? Because there is literally tons and tons of this stuff, and there's nothing in there that resembles a fish. So this presents some problems for those of us trying to study the early evolution of fishes. Because as a reef fauna, during a time period that's known as the Great Ordovician Biodiversification Event, we should expect that if vertebrates existed, and we know they already existed, that they should have been diversifying there. That is, classically, reefs are considered to be cradles of diversification. So if fishes exist, if fishes evolved alongside these other groups, why aren't they there? Well, it's not only that they're not there, they're not actually really diverse at that time. So the fossil record that we have of fishes during this time period, about 480 million years ago, consists pretty much of things that look like this. So this is a Strasbis. It looks like a clamshell that has a tail sticking out the back end. It's found in the Harding Sandstone in Colorado, so geographically nearby this other major reef, but in a completely different environment, in what would have been a near shore environment. And this isn't the only place it's found. There's other things that look like this that are found throughout what was then the two paleocontinents, Gondwana in the South Pole, and then Laurentia along the equator. And so the question was, why isn't there anything more impressive than this? So one possible solution was that maybe it has something to do with preservation. Maybe there's something with sea level. The fishes are there, we're just not seeing them. They're not preserved right, or something like that. So this study suggested that it was related to sea level, that basically you have diversification of all the major groups of fishes. So just to orient you, this is crown nathostomes right here. These are jawfishes, placoderms, which are big armored fishes that show up later. It's not too important to know the names for this talk, fortunately. And then all of these early jawless fishes that some of them look kind of weird. Other ones look like angelfishes. The thing is that most of them show up in the fossil record way after this. So in the Silurian at about 440 million years ago. But the discovery in the Harding Sandstone of these isolated scales, which were thought to be shark scales, ends up pulling all of the branching events, not only in these weird extinct jawless things, but also in modern fishes, back into this time period where they're missing from the reefs. So that's a very big problem. And there's been some debate about whether those are real or not. But basically, it all comes down to, is the fossil record as we see it accurate, or is it inaccurate? Is it telling us something about the early habitat of vertebrates, that they would be susceptible to something like sea level? Or are we just having a massive sampling error? So the way to go about this is to figure out, where should we expect early vertebrates to live? What is the ancestral habitat of vertebrates, and how do we get at that? Well, the way that we can get at that is by using a pre-existing metric that's used for the Paleozoic, so for the early part of the fossil record for invertebrates. And that is this concept, which is the benthic assemblage zone. And so what the benthic assemblage zone does is that it turns the depth gradient, so the depth gradient in marine waters especially, into bins, so that we can bin the occurrences that we do have, even if they're tens of millions of years later, into specific habitats, into specific environments, and see what we actually have, if there's any megabiases in there. So benthic assemblage zone zero is a placeholder for freshwater. There's actually not that much freshwater in terms of environments at this time. One is intertidal, two is shallow subtidal, three is kind of going into the reefs or deep subtidal, four is the back reef, five is the shelf, and then six is the open ocean. And so these are assigned based on things like how the rock itself is deposited. We can tell something about sort of water flow and depth from that. We can also tell from the invertebrate communities, because there's different invertebrate communities in each one of these bins that are pretty universal across this time period. And so what we can do is we can use the fact that we have phylogenies for these things and the fact that we know what habitats they occur in to try to model what the ancestral distribution was. Where are these things coming from? Where are they hiding out? Now, of course, using bins for that, habitat bins especially, is a little bit fraught computationally, as it turns out, because how do you tell when something should be subtidal versus intertidal? What's the rate of change over that? So the way to get around that is to use what's called a threshold model. So the threshold model considers this continuous trait that's called liability. And in this case, we can interpret liability as being sort of the amount of evolutionary change, the amount of evolutionary cost. And the value of liability that's modeled on the phylogeny, when it hits a certain threshold, a certain value that's also modeled, then we have this observed state change from one state to another. So basically what we would expect in an ordered system like the depth gradient is that you would have a certain cost to going from, say, shallow subtidal to deep subtidal, from going to intertidal to shallow subtidal, and that cost can be modeled based on the distribution of occurrences that we know of. So if you have a lot of things that are in, say, one habitat and a big diversification there, then you expect the cost to be generally high. And the nice thing about this is that it lets us incorporate the uncertainty that's in the fossil record, of course. So we don't always, we sometimes have stragglers where they occur in more than one habitat. And so we can make our probability distributions for the tips such that we can incorporate that uncertainty into there. And so when we do this for the earliest occurrences of vertebrates, so the, say, the five oldest sites that include each group, we get a raw output that's something like this. These concentric circles are different ancestral states. So we can also adjust the prior probabilities to account for uncertainty. So in this case, we have sort of the raw occurrences and then a minimum 10% chance of occurring in any bin or things like that. We timescale the phylogeny. We have, in this case, the overall model is Ornstein-Uhlenbeck, which means that it has a central tendency. So you have the distribution of that. And then, of course, the thresholds, which are calculated over different, as values of liability over different generations. So to clean that all up, because that's a lot to get into, basically what it tells us is that while the time scaling suggests that some of the major splits at least did occur back in the Ordovician, as best we can tell, based on the distribution of species. So here we have the first actual occurrences of these different groups versus when their inferred splits are based on the distribution and based on sort of the distribution of their occurrences, that they all originated in a very narrow band of habitats, basically around benthic assemblage zone 2. That is this shallow subtidal zone near shore, ahead of the reef, in what was then very shallow water. So this is actually above the storm wave base at this period of time. So it's not even as deep as shallow subtidal is now. It's only like a few meters. And so what this suggests is that the missing vertebrates, the vertebrates that aren't at early reefs, really are missing. They really do not occur there, that we have this preferential diversification in a completely different hotspot that's much nearer shore. And that even as other groups start to diversify and move out, you still have this continuous diversification, this continuous divergence of major groups in this very shallow water environment. And we can check now that we have all this habitat data together and make sure that this is not a mega bias either. So remember, the other question was, okay, are they there? Are they really shallow water? Is the fossil record representative? But also, is there some kind of sampling error? Is it that we just don't have deeper waters during the times that vertebrates show up? And so it turns out there are a couple ways to check this. One, we can check it against the total distribution of fossil ecosystems during the same time period in a much larger database that's called the Paleobiology Database. And what that shows is that you have sort of centering around the reef right here, and then some occurrences in shallower water and some in deeper water. If we look at ecosystems, the paleo communities that have assignment to benthic assemblage zones, it's pretty evenly split between sort of shallow water and deep water. So remember, this is the place, this is the area where vertebrates are preferentially diversifying. And then we can compare it to things that are the same in terms of preservation. So for example, here we have codonts, which are kind of relative of jawed fishes and their relatives, so something related to hagfish and lamprey, and they tend to occur in deeper water as well. And we can compare all that with the nathostome occurrences in the first part of their diversification, getting even into the Silurian, and they tend to be much shallower water. So they could preserve at the reef if they were there, they just aren't there. So the fossil record is actually really large. It should contain them, but it doesn't. And so that suggests that this early environmental restriction is real. And so this is pretty much an accurate picture of the first vertebrates as we would have seen them in very, very shallow water, not too large, mostly jawless, looking like clamshells with tails, while everything else is out having the fun. But they do in fact diversify later. So shortly after the end of the Ordovician, so starting about 420 million years ago when these things start to show up in the fossil record, we have this diversification of what are actually jawless fishes. So none of these things has jaws, even if they look something like a parrotfish or an angelfish. And then of course you have, again, these weird forms that don't really have any modern analog. And so the question is, why does this happen? Does this diversification actually take place somewhere else? Are there shifts in habitat before there are shifts in body form? Are some of these deeper water? What's actually going on? And so a major way to look at this, the sort of the impact of body form on dispersal or on natal habitat, or the order of changes, that is, does body form change first, or do habitat shifts occur first, is to divide these things into sort of the basic axis of fish-shaped diversification. So on the one hand, we have a bunch of jawless fishes that have this sort of robust, what we call macromeric body form. So they have a lot of armor, they look benthic, in terms of comparison to modern fishes, and they're just much heavier and more robust. And so we have three different groups that evolved these body forms independently. And what we find is that they tend to be in much shallower, they tend to diversify in shallower water or even freshwater relative to the origins of those groups. So remember, the origins of those groups was all in benthic assemblage zone 2, but the diversification of these groups tends to be in sort of benthic assemblage zone 1, which is intertidal, or even into freshwater, with some exceptions that prove the rule. So here we have some shifts towards deeper water, towards say 3, which is part of the reef. For the ones that tend to be less robust and more streamlined. And that that pattern is actually backed up by looking at the other major form that we see in the early jawless fishes, which is what we would call micromeric. That is having small scales, being more gracile, not having heavy armor. And it turns out that these forms preferentially diversify in deeper waters. So into say benthic assemblage zone 3, or even beyond, after originating preferentially in the shallow waters, so in benthic assemblage zone 2. So there are some shifts after their origination where at least the gracile jawless fishes shift and diversify seaward, whereas the more robust fishes shift and diversify nearer to the shore or even going into freshwater. So to summarize all of that, it looks like divergence occurred in microhabitats near shore, where you have the origination of major groups sort of in benthic assemblage zone 2 leaning towards 1, sort of like this clamshell right here. And then those groups that are more gracile sort of move into slightly more offshore into reefs or even into open ocean quite rapidly. There are actually really low thresholds for these groups to move out into deeper waters, so they tend to disperse really quickly. Whereas the most more robust forms that evolve in those same microhabitats tend to shift towards shallower water, they become benthic, or even move into freshwater. And what's interesting about this is the same basic split that we see in other fishes, such as sticklebacks when they invade freshwater lakes, where you end up with sort of a more robust benthic form that tends to be in shallower water, and then a more sort of gracile, limnetic, or pelagic form, which tends to be in deeper water. So what this all suggests is that the same splits actually occur in early vertebrates in this nearshore cradle of diversification. And in fact, what we see if we go back to the biogeography is that in most of these early habitats, say in this time period where you have diversification, you find a single ecosystem that tends to have one benthic group and then one pelagic group. So in the South China Block, where the first jawed vertebrates actually evolved, we have the galeaspids, which are mostly sort of really shallow water, really armored bottom dwellers, living alongside the early jawed vertebrates, which tend to have smaller scales and be more gracile and more free swimming. But it's the same in these other habitats in the other major continent, which is Laurentia, where you have one small scaled, say, thelodont or this parrotfish looking thing alongside another sort of more robust form in the same environment. So there's some sort of niche partitioning going on there as well. And as mentioned, I mentioned briefly, we also wonder, okay, well, when do things actually get onto reefs? When do fishes actually become associated with that? And it seems as though invasion of the oceans was a real event that happened in the Silurian, where multiple groups of mostly gracile jawless fishes actually moved off into the reef and into deeper water, dependent on the body form that they had already evolved in the near shore. And in fact, what we see is that there are two major pulses of dispersal. So if we go back to our benthic assemblage zones and look at how those changed through time, the distribution of jawed and jawless fishes through time, we find that early on from sort of this near shore cradle, we have a dispersal of these jawless, more sort of gracile fishes into deeper water, getting all the way into the open ocean, and then sort of a retraction as we have the second pulse of dispersal of the later evolving jawed fishes, which then become primarily resident on reefs in sort of the later Devonian. So this is about 360 million years ago. So there are two pulses of ocean invasion, first by jawless fishes and then by jawed fishes, which is actually really interesting because jawed fishes are always thought of as having sort of a key innovation, that jawed fishes take over the ocean, that they can eat things that jawless fishes can't necessarily get to. And yet they're secondary. They are not the first group to go and diversify all over the place. They're really sort of the lagging group. And in fact, in following up on this, to see when do jawed fishes come to actually dominate ecosystems, if we look at diversity again, what we can see is that early on, jawed and jawless fishes, for the most part, start to diversify around the same time, again, in the same environments. But it's actually the jawless fishes that start to diversify first and are primarily dominant in the early vertebrate ecosystems, even when the jawed fishes exist. And so this includes things like early bony fishes in South China. And then you see that as the jawed fishes start to diverse, they sort of create this wave of invasion where they displace jawless fishes moving out from their point of origin. So this really shows why looking at things like habitat and body forms and dispersal really matters in getting a handle on why evolution played out the way it did, whether something is a key innovation, why do we see changes in biodiversity through time. And in fact, we can make more distinct comparisons between jawed and jawless fishes as well by looking at sort of other features of their form. So that is by coding ecologically relevant traits. And basically what it shows us in this ordination here is that even at the point when the jawed fishes invade, and if you remember, they were sort of the more gracile group at their origins, they tend to be found sort of more offshore and have body forms that are associated with more offshore lifestyles. Even at the point where they're taking over ecosystems that are dominated by the jawless fishes. So there's still some niche partitioning that's going on even when the jawed fishes take over, where the jawless fishes are still dominating sort of those nearshore habitats, those benthic habitats for quite a while after the jawed fishes show up. So moving into other things that we can look at in sort of looking at what is now really a competitive story between jawed and jawless fishes. Another important axis, of course, is body size and how do body sizes change over time. There's been a lot of debate about this. So body size, of course, is associated with trophic level in fishes and a bunch of other things. But in the paleo record, in terms of macroevolution, the question has been, do we get sort of concerted trends in body size that tell us something, anything, or about competition? And so what's really interesting in the Devonian is that it turns out that all fishes across the world actually increase their body sizes over a period of about 70 million years, including when jawed fishes take over the ecosystem. So we have this concerted increase in sort of the mean body size, the minimum body size, the median body size over the 70 million years of the Devonian. And so we can ask questions as to whether this is due to changes in oxygen, which has been proposed to be a driver of body mass and body size over long periods of time, or changes in temperature, which is thought to be sort of negatively related to body size. So things like Bergman's rule, where things that live at the poles are supposed to be generally larger. And so at least in the case of early vertebrates, as they're diversifying, it looks like there's actually a directional change in body size as the best supported model, which suggests that there's some biotic factor rather than abiotic factors or random walk that is driving this observed trend. And getting more into it to see what's actually occurring as this happens, is it just one or two groups that are getting larger? Is there some kind of selection for things getting larger? Is there certain ecosystems that show this? We can actually go into ecosystems and look to see sort of what size classes we see there, whether there's certain areas controlling this. And what this shows really well, looking at species within ecosystems and their sizes, is that there is in fact an increase, not only at the global level, but at the local level throughout the entire Devonian across different habitats and different ecosystems. So this is a really strong trend, that cannot be necessarily explained by microevolutionary or even ecosystem dependent forces. That if you were looking at a single ecosystem and trying to figure out why do you have a really large predators at this ecosystem and not at this one, you would be missing sort of the fuller story of, say, jawed fish invasion, jawed fish displacement of jawless fishes, and then competitive increases in size that results in the ecosystems that we see by the end of the Devonian. And looking in more detail there as well, we can ask, okay, well, the jawed fishes, maybe they're increasing in size, but the jawless fishes aren't. And what's really interesting is that if we go in and we look at trends within different groups, what we find is that there is no specific lineage that's well sampled that actually shows a decline in size over this time. That things are either poorly sampled, so I have the data points for this in the paper that this is based on, or only show up at the end. But for the most part, everything is showing a concerted increase in size, and that in a multivariate model fitting, everything seems again to show directional selection. But the important thing to see here is that the jawless fishes, which had been sort of stable in size up until the point that the jawed fishes start to take over, also increase in size even as they go extinct in the later Devonian. And they are replaced by finally bottom dwelling, heavily armored jawed fishes sort of in the middle Devonian as they're going extinct, which show the same exact trend in terms of body size increase. So we end up with a late Devonian ecosystem that looks something like this. So the fishes aren't that recognizable to us, so this doesn't really have much bearing on modern biodiversity. It's mostly lobefin fishes and placoderms. There's an early tetrapod right here. But the important thing to note is that everything in this picture is 1 meter or larger. And so this is a nearshore marine ecosystem right at the end of the Devonian at 360 million years ago. So we can talk about how vertebrates got a slow start. They were at the margins of ancient oceans. They then started to disperse out into deeper waters. The local bottom-dwelling fishes held off sort of the jawed invaders for a long time. Then you get this competitive trend towards larger and larger sizes. The trophic levels are filled up, eventually ending up in a situation in which the jawless armored fishes are now completely extinct, and you have this domination by really large jawed fishes. So that's all an N of one, pretty much, which is kind of a problem when talking about these things. Okay, well, we know it can happen, but is it predictable? How often does it happen? And of course, why don't we have fishes that are, say, all the size of blue whales or larger today? Because obviously, if this trend was going on for 70 million years, it's going to keep going on forever. Well, it turns out that there's this really devastating event that happens at the end of the Devonian that kind of wipes this all away. So that's the Endevonian Hagenberg event. So the Endevonian mass extinction, which is associated with sea level fall and a whole lot of other really bad things that happened to fishes at this time. And it really does wipe almost everything away. So 50% of major groups go extinct right at the extinction boundary. So here are, and that's both in marine and in freshwater settings, 97% of species are lost. And then even species that survive tend to show dramatic shifts in habitat, where things that had been primarily marine end up being freshwater from then on and not really diverse again. And we just have this complete turnover of the fauna. So in effect, what we have is this massive reset button at the end of the Devonian. And so this is the part where we get into, what does mass extinction actually do? Is mass extinction more of the same? Does it just sort of start everything over and then have them go down the same pathways as they were before? How does is mass extinction predictable from what came before? How does this actually play out? And what does it tell us about macroevolution? Well, in answer to that first question, this is sort of more what the body size part of this talk was a setup for, that we have this long-term increase in size running up to this mass extinction event, which is caused by totally abiotic drivers, caused by glaciation, sea level fall, everything else. But afterwards, rather than things coming through and just getting larger again and getting right back on that treadmill, we actually have long-term size reduction, but in a kind of a different way than we saw before, where we don't have sort of mostly or all small things like we did in the early Devonian, but instead we have mostly very small things and then a few larger animals alongside them. And so if we look at that in terms of overall trends, what we see in our model fitting is that it's a directional trend with a shift right at the extinction event and then a directional decline going over the next 36 million years. So something about, say, global ecosystems has been fundamentally altered by this extinction event. And so we can look more in depth there and make comparisons because we looked into groups before. So in the Devonian, in that rise of jawed fishes, we had this sort of concerted increase in the size of the two dominant groups at that time, which were the armored placoderms, and then also the lobefin fishes down here. Whereas afterwards, we have either groups that are smaller than the relatives that existed beforehand, that is tetrapods, rayfin fishes are now dominant, and then of course the chondrichthyans as well, are actually reduced in size over that time. In contrast, as I noted, the ecosystems aren't quite the same as what we see in the early Devonian. It's not like it's been reset back to a certain time period. It's been reset altogether. So we also have these large size so-called dead clades walking that are groups that survive the mass extinction but never rediversify. So mass extinction is not a one-off event. It's not like if you make it through, you just keep going and then it's easy street. As I mentioned, 97% of species actually go extinct at the end of Devonian mass extinction. And so everything is reduced to just one or two boundary crossers. But for whatever reason, we have some groups that are dominant and small and getting smaller, and other groups that are no longer dominant, that actually belong to groups that had been dominant, like lobefin fishes, like these so-called spiny sharks up here, that actually are either larger than the last occurrences that we see before the extinction, or actually get larger over time. And what's interesting with that is that that is, of course, exactly the pattern that we see in sort of the last days of the jawless fishes, which suggests that maybe something else other than competition is going on there. And so what this suggests is that maybe time periods after mass extinction are fundamentally different from what came before, that you have these so-called bimodal survival strategies. That is, you have some groups that come out of the mass extinction, either smaller than they were before or get smaller over time during the 20 to 25 million years that it takes to recover from mass extinction. That is to get back to the level of diversity that we saw before. So in the case of vertebrates after the Devonian mass extinction, that again includes things like sharks, especially the holocephalans. So we're talking sharks that are 10 centimeters long. So that when you see illustrations of them, they look really big, they look really sharky, they're actually really small, and they get smaller again over the entirety of the recovery from mass extinction. Rayfin fishes as well, where there's some indication that they actually gain external fertilization at this time. And then they're much smaller than their ancestors were. And then on the flip side, you have these other survivors that are larger than the last occurrences before the mass extinction and actually become larger over time. And what we don't see is sort of the middle ground. We don't see things that stay the same size and just keep going, or just keep going on the same trend that they had before for the most part. So what is this related to? Well, it seems to be related to what size is used as a proxy for in ecological studies. So we know that size is related to life histories, at least in vertebrates. That is, you have things that when they tend to be small, they tend to use less energy to make each individual. They tend to produce a lot of offspring. They tend to mature early. Their life expectancy is short and their lifetime reproductive events are low as well. On the other hand, you have things that are very large or case-selected, which I know that these terms aren't always used, but the concept still applies, where the energy used to make each individual is very high, the number of offspring produced is very few, and the time maturation is late, life expectancy is long. Well, the thing about these is that both of these strategies can be effective for surviving mass extinction. So the reason that you get this bimodal distribution in the ecosystems where you have a lot of very small species and a few very large species that don't rediversify is because if you're small, you can survive an unstable environment. You just reproduce really fast, you hope things work out and go from there. If you're very large and slow reproducing, then you sort of have time to weather the storm more or less just to make it, because the only thing that matters is making it to that next time step. So the things that we see that are smaller, like the rayfin fishes, as I mentioned, it's thought that external fertilization may have independently evolved among them at this time. We know from modern holocephalans that they can have up to 36 offspring in a single season. So they're just a lot more fecund than a lot of the earlier fishes had been, because it turns out that in the Devonian, a lot of those large placoderms, a lot of those large lobefin fishes were internal fertilizers. They gave live birth. They put a lot more energy into reproduction, into their young, and their range sizes are much larger than what we see afterward. And this has effects on the diversity of things afterwards as well. So because rayfin fishes are small, because there are selected, we tend to see them dominate faunas after this extinction event. And we see the construction of sort of modern marine biodiversity abruptly during this time period. We're slow reproducing large things such as lobefin fishes and the placoderms are replaced by fast reproducing rayfin fishes and whole cephalins at that time, with just a smattering of sort of these dead clades walking afterwards. And so the ecological dominance of modern fishes, which I showed in the first slide, is really due to this abrupt shift in global conditions, this abrupt shift in sort of the macroevolutionary regime that happens following this mass extinction and the responses of various survivors to that mass extinction as a result of that. So given the time, I'm going to stop here, but the takeaway is basically that macroevolution has its own rules, that you can, it can seem like you're winning, you can seem like you're spread out, and then suddenly a new competitor emerges in a completely different environment on the other side of the world and invades, that you can have these mega trends like increases in body size, that you can have these biodiversity hotspots where diversification is much higher than it is in other places. And you can have this giant reset and mass extinction where the ability to survive the mass extinction and the responses of individual lineages to the mass extinction conditions then set the stage for what biodiversity will be after that. And so with that, I'm happy to take any questions and thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much, Lauren. Imagine roaring applause. That was really wonderful. Thank you. So folks, please take some time to type in your questions into the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen rather than in the chat function. And I'll do my best to help sort of mediate asking and answering those questions. So maybe I'll lead off. I'm curious about the pace. So I really like the what you've distinguished about sort of that nearshore cradle of origins of biodiversity and marine species. And then we've got these radiations, like you said, both into freshwater and into marine environments. And so I'm curious, either like in the Ordovician or after the Hagenberg event, do you detect much symmetry or asymmetry in the pace of diversification in those two directions, into freshwater or into marine? Because in the modern teleosts, it's pretty unidirectional from marine to freshwater. But I'm wondering if back then, especially after the big reset, if you see things also really asymmetrical or not.
Yeah, so in the initial diversification, So in terms of the phylogeny, the groups that I described as being more robust and going more near shore, it's kind of staggered. So you have, say, one group that tends to be more robust and the next group tends to be more pelagic. And so you have repeated invasions of the freshwater, actually starting before the invasions of deeper waters. So if you look at sort of that chart of dispersal, surprisingly, vertebrates get into freshwaters before they get onto the reef, which was actually not something that anyone expected. Whereas the invasion of the ocean is something that happens separately in all of these other lineages. So there is they do move in both directions. In terms of after the Devonian extinction, we do have shifts towards deeper water and shifts towards shallower and freshwater, like that happen instantaneously over the extinction boundary where things are just have shifted in terms of where their primary habitat is. So we have things like lungfishes, which had been almost completely marine before the Devonian mass extinction, become exclusively freshwater after. And then you also have things like coelacanths, or even some of the holocephalans, which become much deeper water after the mass extinction as well. But in general, in the fossil record, we see movement in both directions repeatedly.
Great, thank you very much. So another question from our audience, from Linda Salmon. What are the advantages of being more robust in the deeper marine environments? What's that relationship between form and function there, these two different kinds of habitats?
Yeah, so being more robust in shallower water seems to have to do with sort of station holding on the bottom. So a lot of these things are very flattened on the bottom. Yeah, their eyes tend to be sort of like on top of their heads. Their mouths are oriented on the bottom as well. So it's just the ability to withstand wave action. Since they're not really free swimming, they're really benthic. The ones that tend to be in deeper water, being more gracile, having smaller scales, having less armor, really seems to help them with sort of swimming long distances and being more streamlined. And then we assume that they swam the same way as modern fishes do, where you sort of have this so tail movement as the primary driver rather than being more maneuverable.
Got it, thank you. Next up, Peter Wainwright asks, so he says, you emphasize mass extinction events and trends in time between them. Yes, if you're making a list of the 4 to 5 big factors that shape deep time macroevolutionary patterns, what would you add to the list after mass extinction and trends?
So mass extinction would definitely be first. After that, I would add in, I think predation and competition in fishes at least has a lot of influence. Predation for the most part on other parts of the marine ecosystem, and then of course fishes have to evolve to take advantage of those prey as well. And then competition between fish groups seems to be a bigger factor. So there's a lot of turnover in the fish record, say between Holocenes and Teleos, or between other groups that aren't as well known, say even like stem and crown teleosts, that don't seem to be connected to any particular event. So we have preliminary data on this. It's definitely not connected to a big 5 mass extinction event. There may be some lesser extinction events that shape it, but otherwise it seems more gradual. It seems more like the kind of thing that we expected from brachiopods and bivalves. And so that's something that we're testing at the moment. So that would be mass extinction, then predation, then competition. And then there are longer term environmental trends as well. So there's the late Paleozoic ice age that happens right after this. And so you have polar ice caps for the first time in a really long time. And in invertebrates, at least, that's been associated with a slowdown in origination. And fishes don't seem to do much after this point either. And so there's some suggestion that that may have an influence as well. And so those are at least the 4 drivers that in my lab we're trying to sort of explicitly test right now.
Great, thank you. I think it's interesting, you know, when you talk to a lot of sort of functional people, physiologists or morphology types, when you see a lineage that really diversifies and that diversification is associated with some feature of their physiology or morphology, there's this tendency to conclude, well, that feature was really important because it enabled, you know, this kind of diversification. But I think, you know, what we see from your work and others is maybe sometimes not even the most important part of things, because mass extinction events can make perhaps something that's less suited for that environment basically be the only one that's left.
Right.
And these sort of just so stories of like why some physiological type comes to dominate is because it's better is maybe not really true all the time.
Yeah, and you know, I would add to that as the fifth thing that I do think that evolvability is part of it. So there is some role for individual ecologies as well, and why some groups are more diverse than others. And so it may be that if you have a key innovation, it's not at least the way that it's tend to play out is it's not important at the moment. It may not drive diversification every time it shows up, but for that particular group, it did end up playing some role, either as sort of a focal point for future diversification, or it was just sort of right place, right time. So for example, things like genome duplication, you can say, well, Telios have had genome duplication, but at the same time, you know, sturgeon and paddlefish have also had genome duplication, and nobody would say that they're very diverse, and salmon have had a second round, but they're still, I mean, there's a lot of species, but they're all identifiable as salmon. So it may not be that it's good every single time in a predictable way, but in retrospect, it's good when it's in the right conditions. It's good at that one point. So I do think there are internal constraints and internal and sort of lineage specific traits that enable future diversification under the right circumstances.
All right, nicely stated, yeah. There's another question sort of about terminology, I guess, is, you know, how is, at least in the way you think about it, how is evolutionary success defined? Is that just maybe the length of time in a lineage is there? Is it how diverse it is? How do you think about evolutionary success?
So I think about it in terms of persistence, that sort of what we see after the Endvonian is that we have two successful groups in terms of what actually makes it through the next 36 million years. So you have the group that's really diverse, which of course increases the chances that they'll make it further in the future. But the dead clades walking are only termed such in retrospect. They're actually an issue in that they persist at low diversity. So whatever they're doing is really successful for that lineage. They still have descendants over that, you know, 36 million years of the of what's called the Mississippian era after the extinction. And eventually they do go extinct, but it's not, but if you were there at the time, they would be alive. They would be as alive as anything else that's there. So that's success in itself. That means that their particular ecology or body form is ultimately more successful in itself rather than just being related to a lot of other things doing other jobs. So it's less dependent on luck, maybe.
Great, thank you very much. Well, I think that's, we're gonna wrap it up for today. I think Dr. Salen still has a couple slots available in her schedule tomorrow morning, Pacific time. So if you would like to schedule a meeting with Dr. Salen for tomorrow morning, would you please just send me an email, Andrew Whitehead. And of course, you're free to follow up with Dr. Salen by email as well if you have additional questions. Thank you all for having Dr. Salen for a wonderful summer.
Thank you very much. And thanks again for inviting me.